It is very much my great pleasure to be here to introduce Rebecca MacKinnon. She's going to be speaking about her new book, Consent of the Networked, The Worldwide Struggle for Internet Freedom. And as everyone knows, this is not only an important topic, but a very important and interesting venue for us to be having this discussion. And just to say a couple of quick words about the author, Rebecca is a senior fellow at the New America Foundation, where she conducts research, writing, and advocacy on global internet policy, free expression, and the impact of digital technologies on human rights. She's the co-founder of Global Voices, an international citizen media network, and she also serves on the board of directors for the Committee to Protect Journalists and the Global Network Initiative. She's also fluent in Mandarin Chinese and has worked as a journalist for CNN in Beijing for over 9 years. And she was also Beijing bureau chief and correspondent from 98 to 2001, and also served as CNN's Tokyo bureau chief and correspondent from 01 to 03. She's also previously been a research fellow at Harvard's Berkman Center for the Internet and Society, where she first began her ongoing research and writing about the Chinese internet. I don't know if that would be the first, but certainly pursued that research area. And so my name is Kate Coyer. I'm with the Center for Media and Communication Studies. Again, I just want to welcome you all on behalf of the Center and Central European University. Our moderator will be Professor Youngmin Kim, who is with the Departments of Public Policy and the Department of International Relations and European Studies, and we'll turn it over to you at the end. But first, please welcome me in welcoming Rebecca here to speak with us. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Kate, and to Central European University for inviting me to speak here. So just to begin with, I'll start with the Arab Spring, because that's very much on many people's mind. Just want to make sure, can you hear me okay? Everything's okay? Okay. And there's been a lot of hype in the media and elsewhere about the role that the internet may or may not have played in the Arab Spring in bringing down a couple of governments and challenging the power of many more. I think that scholars are going to be studying and debating for many years just exactly what role did internet activism play versus old-fashioned on-the-street activism and other factors. To what extent was it Al Jazeera? To what extent was it bloggers? To what extent was it social media? But oftentimes in the press, there's kind of this description as if it was a Twitter and Facebook revolution. And one thing to keep in mind is actually that even the online activism in countries like Tunisia and Egypt was happening long before Twitter and Facebook existed. And one example of this is a video clip I'm going to show you that was produced in 2004, before YouTube even existed, by a Tunisian activist who had gotten hold of a video file of a advertisement created by Apple Computer back in 1984, Apple Computer ran a very famous advertisement that was kind of about how Apple was going to make it so that 1984 will never be Orwell's 1984, because people will be liberated by Apple technology, was kind of the message of the video. And in the anniversary, the 20th anniversary of that video, in 2004, Apple re-released this video, and a Tunisian activist named Riyad Girfali got a hold of this video file and made a mashup, a Tunisian mashup version of this video, which was part of a campaign and a set of activism efforts that by 2004 had already been going on for a couple of years with online activists fighting censorship, using the internet to spread opposition to the Ben Ali regime, and so on, and using blogs, using homemade websites, uploading videos to the internet before YouTube existed, uploading photos to the internet and sharing them before Flickr and other photo sharing sites existed, let alone Facebook and Twitter. So this activism has been going on for quite some time, and here's the product that Riyad Girfali created, and he called this video Aziza's Dream, because his idea was that this that Tunisia was in the middle of a nightmare, which the Tunisian people would one day wake up from. So here's the video. So that's the video, and Tunisia did indeed wake up from the nightmare. But that video also reflects a vision of technology that it is inherently liberating, and that with the skillful use of technology in the hands of activists and with technology created by innovative companies, the world will be set free. But the reality, it turns out to be somewhat more complicated. And the head of the Tunisian Internet Agency, a gentleman named Moez Chakchouk, actually spoke out in public this past fall about the fact that his agency had been testing throughout the Ben Ali regime censorship technology and surveillance technology that had been produced by Western companies and which was being marketed around the Middle East, and Tunisia was serving as a test bed for this technology. He talked about how important, he has now been talking very publicly about how important it is that his agency, which administers the Tunisian internet and administers the networks and kind of handles the regulatory and technical coordination for the internet, that the internet in Tunisia must be a neutral platform for democratic discourse and the challenge of making sure that the internet supports democracy in Tunisia as it's trying to take root, rather than serving as an extension of the regime, which is what his agency was doing under the Ben Ali regime. His agency was censoring and conducting surveillance on internet users around the country at the behest of the government. And so one other really interesting issue was that in May of last year, after several months after Ben Ali had stepped down, actually various leaders and politicians in Tunisia called for the resumption of internet censorship, which had been stopped in January. And they weren't saying to censor the same amount as before, because before it was very heavily censored in Tunisia. But they said, well, there is some obscene content and some hateful content that is not appropriate even in a democracy, particularly in a conservative Islamic society, and so therefore we must block it. And so an order was given to the Tunisian internet agency from the military tribunal, which was running the country at the time, that various Facebook pages and other pages that were considered obscene had to be blocked. And so then what happened over the course of about the following several months was that the internet agency challenged the order. It was taken to court. And several courts ruled to uphold the order. And then it was taken all the way to the High Court in Tunisia last month. And the High Court finally ruled that actually this was not acceptable and that the censorship order was invalid. And so it has been no longer in effect that it was determined that this kind of censorship was not appropriate in Tunisia's democracy. But this leads to a debate that is actually common in many democracies, which is the question of what level of censorship is appropriate in a democracy. And when you have voter constituencies, as you have in Tunisia and as you have in many other countries, demanding of their elected representatives that they should, you know, deal with this pornography, deal with this hate speech, deal with the crime on the internet, censor it, you know, monitor it, surveil it. How do you ensure that those mechanisms of censorship and surveillance that many democracies are putting in place, not at the same extent as Ben Ali's Tunisia, but still have in place, how do you ensure those mechanisms are not abused? And this is a question people in Tunisia are facing as they're trying to build a new democracy. They don't have a good answer, and they look to the West, they look to the more established democracies of the world, and they're not finding a lot of good answers either. They're finding a lot of arguments. Similarly, in Egypt, where there's been a much more difficult transition, an interesting and very revealing thing happened a couple months after Hosni Mubarak stepped down. These are pictures taken by activists who stormed into the state security headquarters outside Cairo. And you'll see here on the left, this was a picture taken with someone's camera phone of shredded documents that were left behind by the state security before they vacated the building. And it was quite amazing. One day I happened to be on Twitter when these people were going through the state security offices, and they were posting online in real time, you know, photos. They were tweeting about, oh, I just walked into the room where I was interrogated 2 years ago. And it was very, very emotional kind of thing. But people also found, and here this picture on the other side is of shelves of many files that did not get destroyed. And some people found their own files. Some people found the files of other people they knew. And, you know, unlike, you know, there are famous stories about what happened after the Iron Curtain came down, and in some countries people were able to see their state security files for the first time and discovered how, you know, friends and neighbors and lovers and spouses and colleagues sometimes had been spying on them. Well, in this case, it wasn't humans spying on people. It was transcripts of their email exchanges and transcripts of their cell phone text messages and detailed logs of where their cell phone had been in relation to the cell phone tower, information that had been captured going in between their computer and their internet service provider. And the activists also found some contracts from Western companies that sell what's called deep packet inspection technology and that were seeking to market this technology to the Egyptian state security forces. So activists in Tunisia today have to assume, well, you know, the regime still has this technology at its disposal, and have to assume that they are potentially subject to the same kind of surveillance as before. And in an atmosphere where bloggers over the past several months have continued to be threatened and arrested, and NGOs have continued to face harassment and arrest in some cases, people are recognizing that they have to be very careful about the way in which they're communicating online and the extent to which they overtly use the internet to organize, and the extent to which maybe they need to communicate offline in order to organize. And so the kind of limitations if they want to avoid a surveillance and potential threats. So what this really highlights is that really everywhere on Earth where there is a significant penetration of internet and mobile phone coverage, you have a situation where the relationship between the citizen and the government is increasingly mediated by the digital platforms and services, our internet platforms, our cell phone services, mobile services, and so on, and that whether or not this layer is neutral, whether or not these services are enabling the government to exercise power in different ways, whether or not power of companies and governments is held accountable in these networks, affects the extent to which citizens are empowered and affects the extent to which citizens can really use the internet to advocate for change, to conduct dissent, to blow the whistle, to say unpopular things that maybe the majority doesn't like, to criticize the ruling party, and so on. And so what my book is really about is, you know, there's a lot of debates and arguments. Is the internet helping the good guys more than the bad guys? Or is it really helping the evil people more than the good people? Or is the internet making us stupid? Or is it making us smart? And my argument is the most urgent question that we need to be asking is not those questions. The most urgent question we need to be asking is how do we ensure that the internet evolves in a manner that is compatible with democracy, that is compatible with an open society, that is compatible with dissent, and the ability of citizens to speak truth to power. How do we ensure that the internet, as it evolves, in a citizen-centric manner, as opposed to favoring government and companies? And I think a lot of times both journalists and activists and policymakers kind of tend to make an assumption about the internet that sort of its nature is kind of a fixed constant. But what you can do on the internet today or what you cannot do on the internet today is the product of decisions of human beings, of engineers, computer programmers, of company managers who are deciding how a service should work, what the terms of service should be in a particular service, and of government regulators around the world. And that is what's shaping our internet. And so if we want to ensure that the internet evolves in a manner that really is citizen-centric and that really serves our rights and interests, we need to engage, because whoever works the hardest to shape the internet to its liking, to their liking, will probably succeed in the long run. And as I mentioned, you know, there are a lot of debates going on in some of the world's oldest democracies about how you find the right balance between various laws and regulations on the internet and free speech. And this screenshot is from the day that Wikipedia went dark in January. When for a day, in protest of the Stop Online Piracy Act, better known as SOPA, in the United States, Wikipedia turned itself off for a day. And the issue was that American lawmakers were responding to the demands of their constituents, or a segment of their constituents, who are very worried about the theft of their intellectual property through the internet and the sale of counterfeit goods through the internet, and the fact that a lot of the piracy and a lot of the sale of counterfeit American goods was happening on websites outside the United States. And so the solution that they proposed and that these lawmakers agreed to was that overseas websites deemed to be infringing should be blocked with what I like to call the Great Firewall of America. That also companies and website owners that basically companies and website owners would be held responsible for the copyright violations and piracy committed by their users. So that would compel website owners to have to police and proactively censor what their users are posting or transmitting if the companies themselves want to avoid legal action and potentially criminal charges. And so the argument from internet companies was that this would stifle innovation. It would make it very risky to start a new business where people are uploading content, because you have to be afraid of being sued all the time if any of your users post something, you know, a pirated video or something. That's a real disincentive to innovate. And civil society human rights activists were very concerned that this would be abused, that the definition of copyright infringement is actually subject to debate. And if you're putting mechanisms in place where you have a blacklist of websites a lack of due process in terms of determining who gets blacklisted or how you get taken off the blacklist. And if you're basically putting the onus on companies to decide, this user might get me in trouble, so therefore I need to disallow their content, that free speech would be affected and that collateral damage would result in terms of the kind of speech that you could see online. Because there have been a number of examples of where basically people have uploaded critiques of companies, particularly. So for instance, there was some information about voting machines that were being used in the United States a few years ago, and some internet users had gotten a hold of some internal documents by that company that made the voting machines, and they had posted them online, and the company succeeded in having them having these documents taken down because it claimed that these were copyright violations, when you can argue that that's a clear example of public interest speech, because the documents that were posted were about flaws in the voting machines and ways in which the vote could be manipulated through the voting machines. But that was taken down due to copyright concerns, and that's just one example of many that people have, that copyright law can be abused to chill speech and it already is being abused, and if you expand basically the law to make it even easier to crack down on copyright, you'll make it even easier to abuse the law, basically. That was the argument. So this is just one example of in democracies, and this is a photograph that was circulating on the internet quite heavily at the time. But it's one example of how in democracies we do not agree about how to resolve problems on the internet while not chilling free expression, while not basically opening the door to greater abuse of power over digital speech. And of course, here in Europe, this is a photo from the protests in Poland recently against ACTA, the Anti-Counterfeiting Trade Act. Again, in Europe, I think there's a similar concern rising about how governments are seeking to resolve problems, not only copyright, but also child protection, also, hate speech and so on, and are seizing at solutions that relate to censorship and surveillance without sufficient attention being paid to, is this going to empower whoever the ruling parties happen to be in various countries to abuse or use these mechanisms in ways that go beyond the mandate? And how do you prevent them from abusing these mechanisms? And what does that mean? And so this is a question that really nobody has resolved. Now, on the extreme other end, of course, you have China. And this is the great firewall of China in action, where there are basically many, many thousands of websites are blocked like this. This is what happens when you try to access Facebook on a Chrome browser from inside China. You get this error message just saying this web page is not available. But this firewall blocking is really only the first layer of censorship in China, even though it's what most of the Western media focuses on. And actually, most of the censorship and surveillance that's happening on the Chinese internet is happening through a system known as self-discipline. And this is actually an award ceremony that I attended in 2009 called the Chinese Internet Self-Discipline Awards, which is administered by the Internet Society of China. And this award is given to the top 20 websites and companies that do the best job of policing their sites. And in 2009, one of the recipients was a gentleman named Robin Lee, who is the CEO of Baidu, which is China's main search engine. And so what this means is that Chinese companies, and because the sort of global social media websites are largely blocked, most Chinese internet users are accessing the internet, are using the internet through Chinese social media platforms. There's Chinese versions of YouTube, there are Chinese versions of Twitter, there's something called Weibo that has gotten a lot of media coverage. And people, it's very lively discussion going on, and lots of fun videos, and people are having lots of fun and having lively debates about many things. And people are even using the internet in China to expose local corruption sometimes and so on. But these platforms are all held responsible for what their users do. So if somebody's trying to use these platforms to really mount a challenge to the Communist Party, or challenge the central leadership, or organize protests, so there was an effort, for instance, soon in the early spring of last year to organize protests kind of in sympathy of the Arab Spring, and people around the country got arrested. due in no small part to help from the social media companies that handed over people's information. And postings, people's attempt to organize was shut down pretty. Basically, what happens is that these websites delete content and shut down accounts that are causing too much trouble and posing too much of a threat to the company's well-being. So here's an example of one blogging platform. There's a social media platform run by Baidu, China's search engine company. And this was this is an example of one attempt I made to post an article about the Nobel Peace Prize winner Liu Xiaobo, who is currently spending a long time in jail. And I wasn't even able to publish the post. When I hit publish, I get this error message that says, sorry, your article has failed to be published. It contains inappropriate content. Please check. And so this is one of the ways in which objectionable content is not just blocked. You know, it's a VPN isn't going to help you. It's kept off the internet. You also have a situation oftentimes where you might succeed in publishing something, but then after about 30 minutes, it disappears. And it's deleted by, there's sort of an automated flagging system with kind of humans checking, and then they'll make a decision whether they need to delete this post, and then they'll delete it. And so that happens quite a lot on the Chinese internet. So we have a situation where the internet is interacting with the sovereignty of nation states in some very interesting ways. In some cases, it's challenging sovereignty, and governments are seeking to control it. But in other cases, you have a situation. So for instance, let's take the United States. The United States Congress might seek to regulate internet companies, or the European Union might seek to regulate internet companies in different ways. And they'll pass a legislation that is based on the interests of their constituents in their geographical location. But this legislation is affecting internet users all over the world. And maybe it's good for the internet users all over the world, but maybe not. So in the case of SOPA, one could make a very clear argument that not, or in the case of ACTA. Yet the internet users in all those other countries have no way of holding these governments accountable. So that's one way in which you have sort of increasingly a sort of mismatch of sovereignty going on, or difficulty in holding the exercise of power accountable. And then, you know, this is a really interesting map. This is from December of last year, World Map of Social Networks. All of the blue countries are the countries where Facebook is the most popular social network. It's kind of a sea of blue. And then you have China, red, which blocks Facebook. So, you know, China has fewer. In Asia, actually, Indonesia is the biggest Facebook country. China has fewer Facebook users than Brunei, which has almost no people. That's kind of how effective the censorship has been, even though, you know, in theory, there are technical ways to get around it, but people aren't using them. And then in a large swath of the Russian-speaking countries, you have a couple of different Russian social networks that are more popular than Facebook at the moment, and through which the Russian government exercises a certain amount of manipulation and intimidation, and so on. And I talk about that a bit in the book, even though they don't actually block web content in Russia at the moment. We'll see how things go now that Putin is back in the driver's seat, and as the sort of power struggles, I think, escalate in Russia and where that goes. But you have also an interesting situation where these internet companies, you know, you see Facebook kind of spanning the globe like this, that it's developing a global constituency, a global user base, and, you know, that people, you know, across the Middle East and North Africa have just used Facebook to challenge the sovereignty of their own governments in different ways, at least to some degree, that Facebook has been useful in that way. So I talk in the book about what I call the sovereigns of cyberspace, or, you know, the people who run internet companies who are making decisions based on their commercial self-interest for the most part. And the question is, you know, to what extent are they considering the public interest? To what extent are they considering human rights, free expression, privacy concerns, and how their decisions end up interacting with the behavior of states in different ways in different countries, and are they sufficiently considering this, and should they be held responsible for considering this? I mean, after all, we do expect companies to be responsible towards the environment, to engage in responsible labor practices, to engage in responsible human rights practices. So why should we not be expecting corporations to engage in practices that are compatible with our human rights on the internet? However, it seems that a lot of these companies sort of resist that notion. But so with coming back to Egypt, you know, on this photo here on your right, you've got Hosni Mubarak being held in the hand of a cartoon of a man who was killed in the summer of 2010, named Khaled Said. He was beaten to death by police who had basically pulled him out of a cyber cafe out of concern that he was going to be uploading some material that exposed police malfeasance. And they bashed his head into a stairway, basically outside the cyber cafe. And he kind of turned into a symbol of regime corruption and abuse and torture. And so Jan25 was the hashtag that was used. And this Facebook page here was the Facebook page that was set up by activists soon after his death, kind of using him as a symbol. The page was called We Are Khaled Said, and the idea being that, you know, everyone in Egypt could end up like him if you don't take action. And so people beginning in the summer of 2010 began to use this Facebook page to organize anti-torture rallies and to really pick up steam for a movement that had actually been going on for a decade. This anti-torture movement was actually not so new. But somehow this Khaled Said case and the Facebook page around it really helped to pick up momentum. But then something happened in late November of 2010. Suddenly the page went dark. The page was deactivated. And it happened to be deactivated the night before a big protest that they were organizing. Why was it deactivated? Because the activists who were administering this page were not using their real names. And therefore, they were violating the terms of service of Facebook, which requires that you use your real name. And someone had brought it to the attention of Facebook staff that this page was violating terms of service, and it got deactivated. And it was only reinstated because these activists, who included Wael Ghonim, we found out later, who's a Google executive, had ties, had contacts and connections in the human rights community and in Silicon Valley, and were able to reach the right people and negotiated a solution to get the ownership of the page transferred to someone in Washington, D.C. who didn't mind using their real name on Facebook. But that's just one example of how the policies and sort of the governance processes of these companies can have a really negative effect on activists, even while at the same time the activists find these platforms really empowering and have become in some countries quite dependent on these platforms. And so the issue of the company's responsibility. Another really interesting example is Apple. And when Steve Jobs died later last year, people around the world were mourning. And some of the most emotional outpourings were actually coming from people in authoritarian countries. There were some really interesting discussions online in China and also in the Farsi, in the Persian blogosphere and in Persian online. And this was a cartoon by an exiled Iranian cartoonist where, you know, he's sort of indicating great irony. You know, an old man says to the angel of death, there are many dinosaurs in Iran, and you go after red apples, which sort of implies that he has more respect for Steve Jobs and more reverence for Steve Jobs and values him more than he values his own national leaders. And this is very interesting that you're seeing in some countries that these executives of tech companies get more respect and admiration and sort of have more legitimacy than people's own leaders do. And that's fascinating. But it can also be dangerous because these people may or may not really care so much about those exact people who are worshiping them. So for instance, in China, Apple has iPads and iPhones, and their app store is censored. So in China, you will not find any apps, as you will in other app stores related to the Dalai Lama or that have any content that is objectionable to the Chinese Communist Party. And even in the West, we've seen Apple censoring apps because they are politically controversial, even though they are protected by local laws and constitutions. So there was a case in the United States where there's this political cartoonist named Mark Fiore who just had very satirical, kind of biting political cartoons making fun of various politicians, and Apple wouldn't approve his app because they considered it too offensive somehow, even though this is speech that is protected by the American Constitution and by American law, and there's like no question. And his app was only approved after he won a Pulitzer Prize for journalism. But there are many other satirists and cartoonists whose also media organizations whose content is, you know, you'd find it on newsstands all across the Democratic West, but it doesn't get approved by Apple's censors because they consider it too racy or too controversial for the environment that Apple wants to create. So that's as we become more and more dependent on these devices and as these private actors are exercising this kind of censorship, which, you know, you click agree when you sign up for your account, you're sort of letting them do this. They reserve the right to do this. What is that doing to democracy over the long run? If it's becoming harder and harder to conduct a controversial speech through these devices. So to come back to kind of the construct I was talking about earlier with, you know, citizens, with these internet companies in between, you know, classically the idea with democracy and sort of with the model of accountability is that citizens vote for their government. And then government, if companies are behaving badly or, you know, if they're poisoning your bottled water or something, they regulate the companies. And that's kind of how the accountability is supposed to work. But increasingly, you have companies buying off politicians so that, you know, the politicians kind of do what the companies want in different ways. And you also have companies, they manipulate what you can do and what you cannot do and what you see and so on. And so they're also having an impact on, you know, what citizens know and do directly. And so one of the things I argue in the book is that we as users of these technologies need to be more active in engaging the companies to change what they're doing and to respect our rights and interests. And you also have the problem that companies, you know, a company based in one country is, of course, making decisions that are affecting people all over the world, even if the managers and programmers and engineers really don't understand the context in which the technology is being used. And there's nothing that's requiring them to understand that context or understand what the unintended consequences might be. And also, you know, one government and seeking to regulate a technical platform or company is impacting internet users around the world who did not vote for that government, assuming that any voting happened at all, of course. So to put it in a more humorous way, and then the other thing is that this is again why I argue that people around the world need to be really directing more activism at companies to get them to be more accountable to the public interest in how they manage and shape their services. But to make the point in a more humorous way, I'm going to show this short clip from Monty Python and the Holy Grail, which is an English comedy from the 1970s, for those of you who are not familiar with it. But it's just a short clip, and then I'll explain it.
First majority, in the case of...
Be quiet! I order you to be quiet!
Order? Who does he think he is?
I'm your king.
Well, I didn't vote for you.
You don't vote for kings.
Well, how'd you become king, then?
The Lady of the Lake, her arm clad in the purest shimmering samite, held aloft Excalibur from the bosom of the water, signifying by divine providence that I, Arthur, was to carry Excalibur. That is why I'm your king.
Listen, strange women lying in ponds, distributing swords, is no basis for a system of government. Supreme executive power derives from a mandate from the masses, not from some farcical aquatic ceremony.
Be quiet!
But you can't expect to wield supreme executive power just because some watery tart threw a sword at you.
Shut up!
So, I don't know how easy it was to hear through this kind of my hacked system here, but you know what's funny about this clip is that you have, it's a mashup of two different ideas of power and two different ideas of how society should be governed and what makes power legitimate. On the one hand, you have the divine right of kings. And there was a point in our history where pretty much everybody on earth just assumed that the sovereign was divinely anointed and that you just had to be governed by whoever God sent to govern you, and you just had to submit, and that was just kind of how life was. And you just had to pray to God that you would have a just and wise king who would be nice to you. But, you know, people evolved. we evolved from divine right of kings, you know, to make a long story very short and to upset many historians who, you know, are more concerned with the details, but we evolved from the divine right of kings to the notion of consent of the governed, that political power, that governance is only legitimate when it derives from the consent of those who are being governed. Otherwise, it's not legitimate. But one of the, and that's kind of now where we are, I would say, is that we have consent of the governed organized around the nation state. But the problem is, for all the reasons that I explained earlier, that's no longer quite working for us anymore in terms of constraining the abuse of power through digital networks and ensuring constraining against government abuse of power through digital networks, or constraining against corporate abuse of power through digital networks, or constraining against the combination of government and corporate abuse of power that happens in different ways, that our existing ways of organizing politics, of organizing economy and geopolitics are not working, but we don't know, you know, we're sort of at the, what I like to call a Magna Carta moment. We're sort of at the moment where we're realizing the system, the old system doesn't work for us so well anymore, but we're very far away from figuring out what to build in its place. We're just kind of recognizing that, you know, there is this sort of global, you know, citizenry, netizenry, people who use the internet, and how do we ensure that as power is exercised by governments and companies through this network, that the rights of all internet users everywhere are respected and protected? And how do you ensure that? And the current system for governing both governments and companies is not effectively dealing with that problem. So just in closing, I want to quote a media studies professor at the University of Austin, Texas, named Rosenthal Alves. He's from Brazil originally. And he likes to talk about the pre-internet age and the pre-internet information society as a desert. And so our governance systems, our economic mechanisms, our entire culture and society was based around information scarcity. And then the internet came and the rains came, and now we're in this rainforest. And there's all these new mechanisms and organisms and all kinds of things that are growing everywhere. And it's a completely different environment. And we haven't figured out yet, you know, we're still trying to make the desert systems of government and the desert systems of economic transaction and regulation work in a rainforest, and it's not working because we set those up for an economy and a polity of scarcity, and we're now in this overabundance, overwhelming kind of situation, and we need to figure out how to build a civilization in the rainforest that works for everybody in society, that protects the weak against the abuse of power, against the strong, that enables dissent, makes it possible for everyone to thrive, and not just those who start out with the greatest power. And we don't have a lot of answers. We're I think, in a very early stage of figuring out how to build this civilization. But I think we are at the stage of realizing that we are in a rainforest, and we're no longer trying to pretend that we're in a desert and make it work. One other thing that I talk about in the book very briefly, or I don't talk about in the book briefly, but I'll talk about now briefly, is what I call the digital commons. And that, in addition to companies and governments, an important counterweight is what you could call the digital commons or digital civil society. The fact that there are a lot of organizations and groups and also just loose sets of individuals who both on the technical side and on the social and kind of media side are creating, you know, on the technical side, software and engineering standards, not for commercial gain, but because they want to build platforms that work, you know, for other reasons, for social reasons, for activism reasons, for other reasons, because they want to share something. You have things like Wikipedia, which are, you know, what I would call part of the digital commons. Citizen media is part of the digital content commons. A lot of communities that are emerging to kind of push back against both corporate and government interests and kind of represent citizens' needs, and also to provide spaces where corporate interests do not prevail, and which are more kind of so. For instance, open source platforms, and I have WordPress up there. Open source software and blogging systems enable civil society organizations to run websites very cheaply, when proprietary systems would make it much harder to run a cheap nonprofit organization. And so the digital commons being a very important counterweight, and that having a healthy and robust digital commons that societies value is, in my view, very important for the future of democracy. And you can read more kind of thorough explanation in the book. But finally, just, you know, in the book and in the talk, I kind of diagnosed a lot of problems, but I'm actually quite hopeful, because the good news, I believe, is that history is not predetermined, and technology is not inevitably automagically taking us in a particular direction. It depends on what we do with the technology. It depends on how we make the technology. It depends on human decisions. It depends on what government officials do. It depends on what people who working in companies are doing. It depends on what we as citizens do to exercise our power as users whose attention is valued by companies, as consumers, as investors, as voters. And as we've seen with other movements, you know, the only reason why companies or governments are doing the right thing when it comes to environment, to the extent that they are, but they're doing a lot better than they were doing 50 years ago in terms of corporate sustainable practices and other things, or the only reason why companies are treating their workers much better than they were 50 years ago, is due to sustained global movements over time. And so similarly, I think we can make a difference. We can move the internet in the direction we want it to take, but it requires equally great efforts we're not going to sort of automatically have the kind of internet we want any more than we're going to automatically have the environment or the labor conditions or the human rights situation that we want. This is something that has to actively be worked for. And so I end the book really with a call for people to view themselves not just as users of the internet, but as citizens of the internet, as what I call netizens. And as the old adage goes, in a democracy, you get the government you deserve. And on the internet, we're going to ultimately get the internet we deserve. And it's up to us to make sure it goes in a direction that is compatible with the kind of society that people in democracies are constantly fighting to maintain, and that people all over the world are daily risking their lives and sometimes losing their lives to achieve. So with that, thank you very much. So people can just come and just take the mic. Yeah.
All right. Before the lecture starts, I was talking to Rebecca. I'm a bit stuck in the middle of my research about the internet activism. And after listening to you, I'm a bit more confused. I can see these submarines of cyberspace, you know, you are emphasizing. But I have a question whether you are weighing more on the citizens, you know, to enforce sovereigns of cyberspace or company and government all together. You know, that's my question, but probably we should collect a question first or?
My brain doesn't work very well, and I find that when we collect questions, I forget the first ones before the other ones got. So if you know, since my brain is not very good, maybe we'll go one by one so I don't forget people's questions. But I think it's a balance of all three that balance each other, counterbalance each other out. I think the problem is that if you rely on government to take care of corporate abuse for the reasons I explained, sometimes it backfires. You know, you often have bad government regulation that are a result of lobbying or special interests or, you know, one party trying to beat the other party. So they're kind of using the regulation to silence the other party. And that ruling party happens to be in power, so they can, so they do. So, you know, if you just count on government alone to regulate the companies, I think the experience shows in many democracies that is problematic. On the other hand, you know, particularly we've got examples with, you know, privacy policies and internet companies recently, you know, with Google, with Facebook, and so on, and telecoms companies that, you know, that regulation is needed, that these companies are, you know, behaving irresponsibly. They're not doing what they need to do. They're not deserving of our trust at the moment. And, you know, if they don't do a better job of respecting our rights, they should expect to get regulated, and they should expect that we demand that they get regulated. So, you know, it's a mix. And then, of course, civil society, you know, there's, of course, a dark side. There's crime. There's, you know, all kinds of, you know, hate groups and so on. You know, civil society is not pure as the driven snow full of angels at all times either, which is why you have governance in the first place, right? So it is a balance that I think we need to find a way to achieve. But I tend to feel that kind of based on what we're seeing globally, we don't have the right balance right now, and we need to figure out how to find it.
God, it's a long cord.
Well, thank you so much, Rebecca, for the talk. And I also perfectly understand this interesting amalgamation of interests and the struggle for freedom, where you have shown that, you know, governments and companies are now alike having an impact on our fundamental rights, in fact, online. And I have just three observations, and I would be interested to hear about your what you think about it. One is, you mentioned it, you know, there is now a showdown on privacy. We see that Google changes privacy guidelines, and we see on the websites when we open search engine that this stuff matters, so you have to read it, so they really are upfront about it, inform. And at the same time, there's no way to really opt out, and many privacy commissioners around the world have responded to that and have asked to postpone the implementation of these new guidelines, and before, you know, they have a chance to assess them, whether they are conform with the national privacy guidelines. And obviously Google doesn't think this is appropriate, they want to go ahead. So that's one observation. The second one is, I have been asked by the OECD to assess policies protect children online, and you already mentioned it's a sensitive area. we want to protect our children online. And there was a particular interest that was also conveyed to me in technology, in solutions that, you know, easily, like the silver bullet, switch off the dangerous stuff online and the children are secure. And technology was really something governments are very, very interested in. And they were disappointed in a sense that I could not convey that, and that I was also not able to say, and that they should be careful with it. And the very last one is, you showed this picture with the sovereign, the corporate sovereigns, and it's interesting, and at the moment these are Americans. Mm. And maybe this is a blessing in one hand, because it brings us at least a basic notion of freedom of speech as we know it from an American context. At the same time, this may change, you know. And also there we see that the corporate interest may outweigh other interests. And I'm wondering how you believe we can really empower the netizen to really deal with the corporations in a way that they would care. Yeah, thanks.
Really good. It was a lot of good stuff. So let's see how well my brain is working to remember your first question, which it has to do with the privacy policies and I guess the question being how we kind of deal with these companies kind of making these decisions, and then I guess it also relates to your second question, which is that, you know, I think one of the reasons why these companies are arrogant is that they feel like their users let them get away with, you know, that ultimately, while the privacy commissioners may be screaming, their users don't mind. Only, you know, maybe some users mind, but the majority of their users keep using their services and so on. And so I really think, and I talk a bit about this in the book, that I think it will be important for users, if people are really concerned about this, to make it more clear to the companies that people care. And right now, there's not it's not very organized, the user activism. And, you know, we kind of expect, you know, in the U.S., this is sort of the EFF will go and have a conversation with Google or so on. But I've also noticed that the companies pay much more attention when they're hearing from people who are the most vulnerable people, rather than from the person sitting in a office who works for, you know, works out of New York, you know, for some organization. And so I kind of have this thought that if we could get users to create sort of global user associations, if you had a global Google user association with people from all over the world, and you kind of model it in some way, sort of like you kind of combine sort of labor collective bargaining with consumer advocacy, with investor advocacy in some kind of new way, and you say, look, you know, without us, you have no business. You are making money off of us. Therefore, we have a right to kind of bargain with you about your policies. And while it would be unrealistic to say, okay, you know, Google must conduct a vote of all its users every time it changes some feature, yet at the same time, I think there needs to be a way that's more kind of systematic and effective to take issues to companies and bargain with them and negotiate with them. And that if this power kind of comes more from the grassroots of users, rather than just whatever NGO kind of appoints themselves to be, you know, speaking for the users without any clear, you know, mandate, really, that I think there are at least some companies that would listen. And, you know, I've spoken to people in some companies who say that they wish they had a better way of having a dialogue with their users than they currently have, you know, which is generally like comments threads on Google Plus or on Facebook or something. So I think there's some really interesting ground, I think, for experimentation and trying to figure out how to organize in new ways to take concerns to companies. Which really speaks also, I think, to the second question, which is, you're absolutely right. I mean, the next internet giants could, well, you know, certainly with networking equipment, with devices, increasingly some of the big giants are in India and China. And elsewhere, and you know, if you look at, you know, Cisco used to be the dominant, and Ericsson used to be the dominant sort of networking equipment providers, and they're increasingly being replaced by China's Huawei and ZTE and so on around the world. And so, this poses some very interesting questions, especially... Yeah, given the political context that these companies are coming out of, and given that, you know, that many authoritarian governments kind of prefer to do business with them, and kind of where that's going to go, and I think that's why it's really important that, you know, this is now the time for the netizens of the world to get active and to kind of wake up. And we're starting to see that with SOPA and PIPA around and ACTA around kind of legislation. But I think we also need similar kind of activism around companies and around kind of global internet governance as well to kind of bring out the moral authority and the voice of people who are using the internet around the world and what people want and what people consider to be illegitimate, what people consider to be unacceptable. I think that needs to be made more clear. And I think, you know, just my own experience with Global Voices, and there's a couple people here today with Global Voices, I mean, there is an international community of people online who actually share pretty common values about the need for freedom of speech. And it's not just purely only the Westerners believe that, but, you know, I mean, through Global Voices, we're working every day with people in Asia and Africa and the Middle East and, you know, Latin America and Eastern Europe and Russia, who all kind of share the same values. And so definitely I think there's a power there that's not tapped right now to really speak to companies and to some of the governance structures around the internet to really try and kind of reclaim that ground.
Okay, well, we have a number of questions.
Yeah, I have a problem with the notion of consent.
Thank you. So the notion of consent presupposes, I'm sorry, the idea of some community. Contrary to this, the internet is not one community. It is a bunch of many communities which are anarchically related to each other. It's the reason why we love internet in the end, it is an anarchy. And my question is whether we have any idea of some overlapping interest among these communities, which I think the freedom of speech is not enough. It is an overlapping value, but it's not an overlapping interest. Thank you.
Yeah, I think you're right. I mean, you know, and I kind of use the notion of consent in a broad way rather than in a very literal way. But it really relates to the legitimacy and illegitimacy of power, perhaps more than consent in and of itself. And how do you ensure that power is, you know, across digital networks while you have different communities that are not all consistent in terms of their needs and values and interests, and that while there are some overlapping themes that, you know, it is not uniform, yet at the same time, how do you ensure that basically the rights of all these communities are protected and respected, and that you do not have a situation where, you know, basically minority communities within certain areas are going to be increasingly squashed because the way in which the internet's engineered and the way in which it's regulated ends up doing that. And so the issue is, how do we find a way to constrain the abuse of power? And I'm not advocating some sort of overarching global governance system or, you know, some world, you know, polity of netizens. That would indeed be ridiculous. So I'm not kind of advocating a total global solution that's particularly coherent because, for exactly, as you said, the internet is not coherent. But at the same time, power is not well balanced. And the abuse of power is not well checked based on the existing status quo of power arrangements. And so I think we're at a point in time where we don't know what the solutions are. We're kind of diagnosing the fact that our ways of arranging power and constraining power and our ways of arranging politics and our ways of arranging economics and business norms is not succeeding in constraining the abuse of power online, or is also not succeeding in stemming a trend in which the internet is more and more censored and surveilled everywhere. So I think the solution is not going to be a centralized one or a holistic one. It's going to be distributed. It's going to be the result of many communities kind of taking action and working on solutions. But I guess the point being that if we just leave things the way they are now, the trend lines are not particularly good in terms of any community online sort of maintaining its rights, unless they happen to be allied with whoever's in the majority political power in any given place or allied with the major corporate players. And so if you're not allied with one of those, then, you know, the chances of your rights being respected and protected are highly diminished. And so what do we do about that? And again, I do agree the solutions are going to be distributed and decentralized and chaotic, most likely, because that's, if we want to keep the internet the way it is, that's how the internet is. You're absolutely right. But how do we just enable that to happen? Which is why in the book I don't offer sort of Rebecca MacKinnon's solution to fixing the world. It's more like, you know, we're kind of at this moment, which I call the Magna Carta moment, as opposed to some later moment where we're recognizing that the old system doesn't work, but we really don't know what it's going to be replaced with. And the only way we're going to find out is a lot of people trying a lot of things, you know, most of which will fail and some of which will succeed and perhaps take us to a better place, or to the place we want to go as opposed to the place we don't want to go. But it's only going to we're only going to go the place we want to go if we make an effort, as opposed to, oh, technology is just going to take us where it wants, you know, which I don't recommend.
Because I just wanted to comment. I mean, just in relation to that I'm from Warsaw originally. I'm since three years here, but and yeah, this concept of the network. Actually, I liked it because it connects, you know, the codes that run the states, which is law, and the codes that run the cyberspace, which is the technical codes, and that in Poland people were pissed because not only of the contents of the ACTA, but also, for example, by the fact that, well, the first government said that it consulted the law with, I mean, there's a obligation of public consultations of this legal act, and he consulted it, but only with the, you know, one side. Well, I mean, with the interested parties from the producers' side. So in this sense, then people went on the went out of the street. Well, the government backed up, and then he invited the, you know, guys who are speaking the loudest, which is like representatives of various NGOs. But then when you were reading like the post on Twitter and on Facebook, you could see that many voices saying, yeah, but they don't represent me. I mean, why? I mean, I don't identify myself. I identify myself with the crowd, but not with the guys who were consulted about what to do in this kind of miserable situation. So from this, I gather that really the most important question is the question of how to deal with the problem of political representation in all this, because, I mean, on the other hand, like, this activism also springs this, it has a very strong anti-political moment. It says, I mean, why should we have any movement or any organization if we are already so well connected, which sounds very illusory. And the second thing I wanted, I mean, this, and this is a question about, because you didn't mention that much the problem of leaking, and whether there should be another ethical code for when it is appropriate to leak things and so on, so because it's not only about censorship on the part of governments, it's only about of this type of activity, and I would like you to comment on that.
Hi, I just wanted to ask what you thought of the anti-SOPA campaign and whether you thought it really was some new form of online activism and digital populism or whatever you want to call it, or whether actually it just showed the power of Google and that it wouldn't have been possible without Google. That was all.
All right, I'll collect one more.
I'll just make a short comment about your parallel you do between human rights and how we can transfer them on the internet, and what's happening in real life is that we have the courts, we go to court to defend our rights that have been violated, while what we're missing in the internet and in the online is this system of courts of a third party that would be neutral and that could judge any potential human rights or web rights violations. And I really think we should focus on kind of trying to identify a mechanism, but I know this is not within the scope of your book, identifying mechanisms, but that practically it will pose many, many problems, because coming up with an international Strasbourg court, for the online, is going to really be complicated to put in practice. But other than that, while we should be expecting for the government to act as a regulator and as the neutral party, because the policy of the companies is actually companies act as the government in the online. Yes, they set the rules. And then what would we expect the real government to act as the court, as the neutral part? We see that they're an interested party that will most likely never defend the rights of the citizens. And then, I think that the implementation part is really going to haunt us for a long time in trying to identify a practical solution.
Thank you. Just one more and
Okay, so I just wonder whether you would think it a too optimistic view to say that the internet seems to be a largely free system, which the freedom of which can be protected in better working democracies, even if there are attacks on by companies, governments, or both of them allied. But unfortunately, it's also flexible in a way that when it arrives to environments which are not democracies, or then it just adapts in a way. So in other words, it might be that the danger is not necessarily that the whole thing can be turned to a not open, not free system, largely, typically, but unfortunately it doesn't work in a way that it, when it arrives to an environment where the rule of the game is not openness and freedom, but restriction and censorship, then it would still function without extra restrictions.
Let me try and, how much time do I have? So I guess coming back to the sort of both, I think the anti-SOPA thing and the Poland sort of anti-ACTA thing, I mean, I think we have seen a turning point in terms of activism, but there is definitely this question of, who do these groups represent in speaking on behalf of the people, and this is always a problem with civil society. It's been a problem with human rights groups and environmental groups who does Human Rights Watch represent actually, or, who does Greenpeace represent actually, and so on. And so, at the same time, you had the core problem with the agreement in the first place, which was that if the governments had actually consulted all stakeholders that would be affected, and really, conducted a thorough consultation and really conducted really sort of a civil liberties risk assessment on this treaty or on SOPA, if they had conducted like a human rights risk assessment on this bill, it wouldn't have gotten very far because the conclusion would have been obvious. But, you know, they were just so focused on responding to the aggrieved parties and the aggrieved parties, you know, desire for an easy solution that, you know, then you have this situation, then you have lots of groups and so on. But, yeah, and there is this question, too, about, you know, just is politics working at all? Is government working at all? The whole issue of leaking and sort of anonymous and WikiLeaks and kind of what role do they play? And what is the alternative to politics? To what extent do you need government? To what extent do you need secrets? To what extent do you need privacy? You know, these are all questions I think we're seeing kind of debated anew. I mean, I tend to feel that whistleblowing is absolutely vital to be possible and to be protected, and you know that it's an important part of dissent. But I also disagree with those who say that governments should never have any secrets and there should never be any classified information, or that companies should have everything public. Because I don't see how you can run a company or a government, even a very, very good company and a very, very good government, with no mistakes happening, if everything's out in the open all the time on a wiki. That, you know, I mean, I've just myself seen as a correspondent in China and negotiations that the United States government conducted with the Chinese government to release dissidents from jail. If those negotiations had been public and had been leaked, those people would still be in jail. And so that's one example of where I think that some leaking can really expose wrongdoing, but just sort of leaking everything just for the sake of leaking can be really irresponsible and really harmful. And so then this question is, you know, how do you kind of come down on this? You know, who decides what is a good leak and what is a bad leak? And who is moral and who is immoral? And it's a really tough question. But I guess part of the problem with some of this business with WikiLeaks and Anonymous is that there's sort of a segment of the online activist community that is basically anarchist, that basically doesn't believe in government at all, that thinks, you know, not only should the Chinese government be destroyed, but so should the United States government and all other governments. And that's fine, okay, but, you know, sort of what do they seek to replace it with? And, you know, what's that going to lead to exactly, and what are the actual solutions and alternatives that people propose? And I sometimes worry about that. And I, you know, as someone who I started my academic life studying the origins of the Chinese and Soviet revolutions, and so I get a little bit worried about people who are just, you know, fight the power and, you know, ends justify the means, and we'll figure it out once we've destroyed it all. And historically, that has tended to have a very bad result. And it just seems that, you know, human society sort of is very political, and, you know, can you really, you know, expect to sort of achieve perfection or eliminate, you know, all bad things about government or all bad things about politics without actually having a remedy that's worse than the problem you were trying to fix? You know, and I guess which kind of comes to this whole question of, I probably won't be answering your question exactly, but what is freedom actually, and what is internet freedom, and what does a free internet mean? And, you know, just as in, I think in the context of our physical lives, when we talk about political freedom, we're not talking about you have freedom to absolutely do anything you want at any time to any person, and, you know, freedom to, right? You know, there's a reason why we have governance, which is that if you have anarchy in physical world, women and children are not free, minorities are not free, they're physically threatened, they can't go out of their house without fear for being killed, raped, abducted. So, you know, with total non-governance, actually, there's a lot of people who end up being very unfree. And only the strongest and smartest and most capable are actually maximally free. And so I think we need to be careful about the way we think about freedom and what it means, and the way we think about governance and what it means. Of course, you need governance that's accountable and that's serving the interests and protecting the rights of the governed, not serving the interests and rights of, you know, companies and governments and, you know, trying. So, you know, how you achieve accountable government, how you use dissent and leaking to make government more accountable, or are you using dissent and leaking to destroy government? I think you can arrive at very different kind of points about what's acceptable and what's not acceptable. But we're sort of, I think we don't have a lot of social consensus right now about where we want to go. And I do worry a little bit, again, having studied the Chinese and the Soviet revolutions, and the very idealistic young people that were at the core of them, who really thought that they were about to build a better world and really believed in the utopian ideologies that they thought were going to transform society, and then look at the nightmares we ended up with. So I'm a little bit worried about perhaps, you know, maybe if some of the people in those movements kind of look at history a bit more, maybe they might stop to think a little bit more. Yet at the other time, you know, we need movements, right? You know, so I'm calling for movements, but I think we do need to have a bit more thought about kind of, and debate and discussion about what it is, where it is we're trying to go. And are we sort of going for a revolution? Are we going for, you know, just more accountable governance, or what is it that we're doing? Do the ends justify the means? And so on, and I think there's a lot of ahistoricism, I think, you know, that might benefit a little bit from talking to people's elders who maybe aren't on the internet so much, but who've been through some revolutions in the past and have some, you know, wisdom to impart that might be quite useful. But where was I? Just on other questions. I don't remember. I guess the other thing about SOPA, I think it was a turning point. I think the reason the anti-SOPA protests, I mean, certainly Google was very active, but I think the reason why they were successful ultimately was not Google, it was Wikipedia. Wikipedia is an NGO. It was the civil society organizations that came behind this that really gave it moral authority. And if it had just been Google and Facebook and Twitter, lobbying, you know, in a lobbying contest with the entertainment industry, I think SOPA would have been passed. I think what it was is that you know, people were calling their Congress people that you know, that they couldn't get on Wikipedia, that they were really kind of, it really resonated with people that this was about civil liberties. This was not about saving Google. And that's why it was effective, and that's why people in Congress listened. Did the fact that Google was, you know, opposing it help? It certainly helped. But there are times when companies end up being on the right side of a human rights issue due to their own corporate self-interest. And that's fine. You know, let's find ways to make it more frequently the case that their corporate self-interest actually aligns with human rights and civil liberties. That's just fine with me. I don't think they need to kind of go through a test of sort of their ideological moral purity before I'll accept them as an ally. But that's just me. Anyway.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. I believe social governance and activism supposed to stay somewhere in the middle, well balanced. I often witnessed good activism or activists are only good at opposing, but when it comes to in power, they just could not handle. So, okay, I think, thank you very much. We need to end. 10 minutes passed already. Okay, thank you. Thank you, Rebecca.